Welcome to the Smart Property Investment Show with your host, Phil Tarrant.
G'day everyone, how are you going? Thanks for joining us on the podcast today. We're recording on a sunny Friday afternoon in Sydney. Looking out the window, it's looking pretty good, and I know a lot of people preparing for auctions over this coming weekend, and depending who you speak to, it would appear that property markets in Sydney and Melbourne are starting to move out of a downward phase into something which is at least flat and some areas sort of going up. So we've been chatting about this for a little while now, and we'll keep our eye on it, but every single day we're writing about it, smartpropertyinvestment.com.au, so make sure you go and check it out. But I'm not here today to chat about Sydney and Melbourne property markets and whether or not markets are stagnant or moving. We've actually got a couple of investors in the studio who have been looking to get in here for quite some time. I've eventually collared them when they were wandering around drinking coffee. They're colleagues of mine here at Momentum Media, who's the parent business to Smart Property Investment. So I've dragged them in. They're brothers, friends, sometimes enemies, Michael and William Magee. How you going, guys? You well?
Yeah, good, Phil.
Thanks for having us on.
No, thanks for joining me. So I work really closely with you guys across the business, which I do enjoy, and I'm quite familiar with your backstory. So just wanted to explore a little bit of that for the benefit of our listeners and how you've gone from being a couple of knockabout paddy backpackers into building corporate lives here in Australia and now investing in property. And Will, we sort of got together, I think, about
a year or so ago
on the podcast, and you were lamenting about entering the property market. So give us an update.
Well, it's a dream, isn't it? So when myself and Michael started here at Momentum 5 years ago, you know, you look around and we've got such incredible resources at our fingertips, you know, considering the fact that we've got our finger on the pulse in multiple different markets. Obviously, property investment is a huge one for us, but the fact that we produce the news in mortgage broking and in real estate as well, and obviously in broader financial services, it gives us, you know, a great bird's eye view as to everything that's happening. And, you know, we envied everyone else in here for quite some time that was able to get their foot on the property ladder. But for us, the one initial barrier was obviously getting permanent residency. So the last time we spoke, myself and Mick had saved up a couple of quid. Mm. And then we were looking at a couple of options in terms of investment. Yeah, since then we've made the leap. We've bought property number one, and now we're looking to potentially buy property number two.
Okay, Margaret, where'd you buy? Tell us about the property that you secured.
So we purchased up in Moreton Bay.
Okay.
In a place called Kalanga.
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 Yeah. Kalanga. I got a couple of properties up there.
Yeah.
Good spot.
It is, yeah. I think what we found attractive was the buyer's agent, which we use. They said that there's going to be a university finished next year, the end of next year. Mm. So I think the population in this suburb is going to, you know, double. So irrespective of what was going to happen with any market conditions, you know, kind of took away any worry about the property ever being kind of, you know, let out, rented out. So that's was a big driver for picking that region.
How much did you pay? How much was it?
Oh, 362, I think, was it that we got?
Yeah, 365. Yeah.
365. Yeah.
And it's been rented from day one?
Yeah, it was already let when we purchased it.
Okay, same person still in there.
Same person,
yeah. What's the rent you're getting up there?
I think about $1,500 a month. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah.
So not bad.
Yeah. Not the worst, yeah.
And you co-invest, right? So you're both on the title.
Yeah.
How did you structure that?
No, actually, sorry. It's just my name's on it. So when we spoke last, so the buyer's agent advised us that we should
just put one person on title.
Well, no, he actually said that we should probably go into a trust arrangement, create a trust where both of our names are in the trust and we can start purchasing property through that, rather than both of us putting our names on the title, simply because we don't know what our personal conditions are going to be like down the road, you know, whether we're married, you know, whether someone ends up breaking up with someone, you know, whatever might happen that we haven't foreseen as of yet. He said, look, to be safe, put it in a trust. And so we explored that route, but talking to the accountant, it became obvious quite quickly that a trust option or even putting both our names on something probably wouldn't be the best idea, because down the line, when it comes to securing any further credit to buy anything else, when a bank looks how much debt you have, even for an individual, they look at the cumulative total. So even if your serviceability is, you know, pretty strong, if you've got a huge amount already out there, they're going to be less inclined to loan you any more money.
So you're on the title. Are you both on the mortgage or?
No, it's just Will. So we're advised by the accountant. Yeah. Go one for one.
So you just got a pigeon pair moving forward. Okay. Yeah. So then at the point in time, if So at a point in time, if you have these separate sort of assets that you're both, you can just, it's easy to unravel it, right?
Yeah,
you know,
yeah.
if you want to have sort of, you get married or something happens, then you build out this portfolio, but you're doing it as a combined effort. So you're both contributing financially the deposits into this stuff. And then, so you'll just go.
That's it. There's, I suppose it's unique, but there's a couple of benefits. First of all, two of us saving together is, you know, keeping another person accountable means that, you know, instead of funneling your money into the local pub, you know, you're actually, you know, you both have committed to put X amount into a bank account and you get to that, you know, deposit amount a lot quicker. Well, I suppose because myself and Will are brothers, you know, we moved over here together. We actually live together. We work together. We're very close. Mm. We didn't need to enter a trust because we, you know, by the virtue of what a trust does, we trust each other. Yeah. So we're quite fortunate kind of that situation. But I think that's quite interesting to see now, you know, friends and people saving for deposits together, even though we might not be people in relationships, you know, to get their foot on the property ladder. So something definitely worthwhile thinking about.
And if you put a legal agreement in place to support the strategy of yours, or you're just going, look, nope, you know, we've known each other for a number of years and we can sort of push through it.
Yeah.
He could, you know, land me with a $362,000 loan now if you wanted.
The market completely crash here and I'll just head off to Barbados.
Right? So how does it work for you guys? So you both said that every single month when you get paid, you will contribute into a shared bank account.
Yeah.
Is that how you do it?
So the plan was $32,500 per annum each is what we're looking to put away to continue with our strategy of buying one property per year for the next 5 years within that bracketed range of 350 to 500. Mm. So yeah, at the moment, well, we were doing pretty well for a while, putting away $3,500 each a month. But then a couple of holidays got in the way.
When we come back, I'm going to ask you about that because I want to see who's contributing the best.
Yeah.
Welcome back, everyone. I'm here with Michael and Willie Magee. We're having a chat about how they invest together and they've got quite an interesting strategy. And when we left off before the break, we're chatting about whether everyone's contributing into this shared bank account. Who's the best? Who's a steady hand? Who's sort of missed the ball the most?
We're both incredibly on par. We really are. There's been a couple of months, you know, where someone is a couple of grand ahead of the other.
And that means someone else will have to have a dry month the next one. Then.
Is that why you haven't been drinking the last one?
That's it, Phil, yeah.
So how did you come up with that number?
Well, the buyer's agent, when we asked them what kind of price range for our strategy would be ideal for the size of the house, we reverse engineered it from that to get, you know, what our down payment would need to be, you know, at 10% LVR, plus obviously buyer's agent fees, lawyer fees, whatever else. Yeah, it leaves us between the 65 and 75K mark.
Actually, on that note, the buyer's agent, without that sort of advice, and actually that trinity of advice from the agent, the mortgage broker and the accountant, yeah, we'd probably still not have a property.
Trinity of advice. You've been reading something, have you?
You can use that word around. Yeah, smart property investment.
Smartpropertyinvestment.com.au. You can use all the terms there. But I just want to keep on this money thing. So you both contribute to a shared account and we've worked out how you spend that money. Are you guys compromising your lifestyle and all the reasons why you came out to Australia on the basis of investing in property, or you're still doing what you really want to do? You don't feel like you're missing out because you're choosing to invest in property?
Well, no, not at all, Phil, because if you backtrack 7 years ago, we're in Ireland during the GFC. Mm. I won't tell you what our wages were then, but, you know.
I know how much you guys get paid, by the way.
Yeah, right. Yeah, well, then, well, before we ever met you, Phil, and before we got on the plane, our uncle, who's an Aussie, you know, he said, I think that the minimum pay rate was something like $20. Mm. Our jaws hit the ground, you know, when we heard that.
Well, $20 an hour.
Yeah.
Oh, so you thought that was big.
Oh, enormous.
Yeah.
We need to renegade your salaries.
Shouldn't have dropped that one in there. But, you know, fast forward 7 years to think that we'd actually have a property now is pretty, you know, we wouldn't have thought that then, you know, and then, you know, we're on course now to get a second one. So, so it's not really, you don't notice once you park it aside, it's not something, you know, you change adapt your lifestyle then to cater for that.
Yeah. So you don't feel like you're not doing the stuff that you want to do because you've chosen to invest in property?
No, not at all. Yeah. And we're probably healthier as a result of it as well, you know.
And this sort of attitude towards property in Australia versus what it's like in Ireland. What did you guys spend 500 odd grand on this place in Kallunga, 565 or something? Was that right?
No, it was 365.
365. So do you convert that into euros and go, oh, back in Ireland, I could have bought this? Like, do you think that's expensive?
You're not buying much in Ireland. The Irish market's absolutely crazy again. 200 grand, I'm not sure if you'll get anywhere in Dublin or not for, you know, for that amount of money. Yeah. We wouldn't be able to, certainly not in a capital city, you know, be able to invest in the way that we've done.
Okay. Especially not from here as well, because you need 35% LVR, because technically we're not tax residents there anymore. So,
Interesting.
Yeah.
So what's next then? Like, when's the next purchase?
Well, yeah, so we were dragging our feet a little bit in terms of which we were putting away. And we met with the buyer's agent prior to the election, and he gave us a bit of a kick up the arse, scared us if the other party had gotten in, you know, what the new tax implications would be for anyone who's buying a property before Christmas time. So we got our acting in gear and, you know, accelerated our current savings. So we're hoping that towards the back end of this year, we'll be able to buy our second property. Where? Just yet, I've no idea. Obviously, things change quite quickly. So where he shows us come October, November, December, it could be a lot different.
And you use the same buyer's agent?
Yeah. We trust him now.
Yeah. Trust him now?
Yeah.
Didn't trust him before. Well, let's have a chat about that. You know, in Ireland, do people use buyer's agents?
It wasn't anyone when we were there. I don't know. Maybe there are buyer's agents now, but I think it would be a pretty unique phenomenon.
Yeah, I think Irish people are quite frugal in their mindset towards paying someone to find something that they think they can find themselves. I think it's quite different here, you know, and we would have been lost without a buyer's agent, and even having that, you know, a good understanding of, you know, being across, as Will said earlier on, you know, these different kind of financial and property titles, still didn't feel confident enough without using one plus just take all the hassle out of it, you know, just like too busy to go and do all that homework, you know, just made it so easy. So.
Well, you talk about the trinity of advice beforehand and a broker, a property buyer, an accountant, right? You've got to get these things right and you've got to trust them. You've got to be really open and transparent with them. So how did the buyer's agent work out what was the right strategy for you guys? When you look at the property you have now in Kallinga, why was the recommendation there? Outside of the fact that, you know, you mentioned beforehand,
we said we're not looking for somewhere where we're looking to extract. We're realistic. We don't want somewhere where we reckon we can extract equity within year one, year two. We're looking for somewhere where you think, you know, should go through growth cycle within the next 5 years, and we want to continue with that strategy 4 or 5 years. So when it comes to that point, and we can continue to, you know, travel on the path that we're on right now and buy a house each year, but we'd also at that point like to have some equity that we can take out, potentially start doing some cooler stuff like, you know, subdivision development, whatever it might be. And he held our hand and said, these are the areas that, you know, I expect to see, you know, solid growth in with the money that you're looking to invest. This is, you know, where I think you'll get the best bang for your buck in the medium term. And we just went with it. We trusted his advice, and that's how we've
We weren't really looking for anything that was like cash flow positive, because it's both of us, right? Yeah. So, you know, it's like somewhere that's cash flow neutral, or, you know, so, and just hopefully have a bit of capital growth, you know, over the years. And it's a kind of slow, steady performing portfolio, so 5 to 10 years.
And when you went through that journey buying a property through a buyer's agent, was there any time where you started wavering on it, thinking,
to our detriment, actually. Right. So again, you know, it's obviously a big financial decision. So they had put a property in front of us that was about 400,000. And they said, look, you've got about 24 hours. It's really attractive. It's X amount under market value. You know, you got to jump at this. And
we've got an approval for subdivision already. It was in a rezoned area, and, you know, all of this stuff we didn't know. We're like, oh, a buyer's agent will be able to keep bringing us these type of opportunities. But, you know, this was a bit of a diamond, and we didn't move on it quick enough and someone else took it. So
We're a bit apprehensive about it. So we said,
can we have, you know, the weekend to think about it? And, you know, we didn't even get the weekend. By the end of the day, someone else bought it. Yeah.
So if you think about how you could have done your first buying process better, would that be, I wouldn't call it a mistake, but it sounded like an oversight or something that you wouldn't make that mistake again?
Yeah, well, it's...
Or you reckon it's just part and parcel of investing in property?
I reckon so. It's part and parcel. I mean, you know, if it had gone the other way and we had just jumped, you know, straight into something and we regret it now for whatever reason, you know, we wouldn't have been as happy. But, you know, yeah, of course, it's a small regret in that, you know, obviously this was an incredible opportunity, but other opportunities hopefully will come up down the line.
Would you say, Michael, your risk appetite is the same as Will's, or is one of you more risk averse than the other?
No, we're kind of on par there.
Do you reckon you guys where's your risk levels between sort of Mr. or Mrs. Conservative and go with whatever.
Where I reckon go with it, yeah. Yeah. Well, I think we're both fairly, you know. We're
like a punt.
Yeah. We'll just gamble it, roll the dice. Like,
and that's the approach into the next property. When you're ready to go, you'll go?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Yeah, yeah, big time. Mm. Yeah. I know, like, I was chatting to someone else that works in the business here, and she's at the exact opposite end of the spectrum.
I know who you're talking about.
Yeah. You know, she was talking about growth in her portfolio, and I was like, amazing, take that out and stick that into something else. And she's like, no. I just want to get this mortgage paid down, you know. But for me, it's like, let's, you know.
Yeah, and you think coming from Ireland, actually, you know, like, we saw the housing crash over there, that, yeah, you know, we'd be a bit more adverse to this, but no, not at all. Just kind of, yeah, gone with the Aussie way. So but have
you're
a go.
Still, you're still both quite young, right? You're both early 30s, right? So if you get it wrong,
yeah,
you start again.
Exactly.
You
know? Yeah, yeah,
and
yeah.
I think as people get older, their sort of profile, yeah, to risk sort of,
yeah, head to a different,
know,
country,
change a bit. And, yeah, well, you don't do that so often, right?
Yeah, yeah.
And sort of moving forward for you both, when you consider, you know, your contribution to this asset, this savings to keep driving and pushing it forward, who's like the decision maker out of you guys? How do you go about making decisions? How often do you talk about property? What's the mechanism that you have to talk about property so you can make informed decisions? Is that when you go for a beer or something? Is that when you do it?
Yeah, well, it's a hobby thing for both of us. Mm. So it's just whenever one of us reads something interesting, we'll share it with the other person on WhatsApp, you know, mm-hmm, and then we'll chat about it when we get back to the house. You know, we're always talking to our mates about it. I think, and I know it's boring. I want to be able to say that one of us is dragging the other along, but we're both, you know, I think equally as invested in it. Yeah.
Yeah. So. And there are other motivations now. We want to get our dad over here. So we want to move him over here. So we were probably steered the buyer's agent to, and we want to live in Sydney, you know, stay here, maybe to get somewhere near or in New South Wales, you know, somewhere that's...
Oh, you park your old man into it.
Yeah, affordable. Yeah. And, you know, I suppose in a proximity where, you know, we can see him from time to time, but not too close where he can just drop in for a cup of tea whenever he wants, you know. So that's kind of, you know, that's kind of the next consideration. So it's not just about us.
But that's when you sort of... We get into that sort of gray area of property investment where you're mixing, the mechanics, and it is an investment vehicle versus sort of personal or emotive sort of games.
Yeah, where
as
it gets
well
a bit more complicated.
Yeah, yeah. But, you know, I know people that have done it really well. And when you look at your journey through property investing, you have one property, you're looking to build a portfolio out. You're fortunate that you work within a business that you can pick up the phone and pretty much talk to anyone in Australia around property. Like, you're really fortunate. There's no excuse for you guys not to be educated around property if you want to make the effort to do so. But outside of that sort of stuff, what's been your biggest influence, or what source of information, or
are you looking for some props here, Phil?
No, I wouldn't say me. I don't know anything about property, to be honest with you. I use the trinity of advice. A really good accountant, a really good property. What's been your biggest influence?
Look, when I started at Momentum Media, I started out on smart property investment.
That's
you
right,
know.
Yeah.
So I know it was a long time ago, but you do read these massive success stories, you know, and they're happening every day. And just to see other people doing this stuff, it's like you want to do it as well. And why not? What's stopping you? Mm. You know. So yeah,
it's pretty funny that your attitude towards buying property kind of in Ireland. You're like, when we're there, oh God, I'd love to own my own home. But, you know, over here, it's just an asset class for investment,
yeah,
you know, that's why we see it here. You know, we haven't even seen our property, you know. It's like, it's always seen as a picture of it on a magnet on our fridge sent out by, you know, the buyer's agent.
No, it's a real estate agent. Yeah, yeah. Looking to flog it for us. Yeah. Here's your gaff.
And you mentioned really early on the chat, Will, that the concept of buy to let in Ireland is like a negative term.
Yeah.
So this is being a property investor. So is it negative view if you're a property investor, or is it negative to actually use that as a way to create wealth?
So because people over leveraged themselves so heavily in the late 90s and early 2000s, that was a huge reason for the property bull and the impending crash. So now when people talk about buy to let, you know, there's a little bit of a negative, you know, cloud that surrounds it. You know, the banks were obviously given, you know, 0% loans, same way as they were in the States. And, you know, now with housing going so crazy again in Ireland, and, you know, rent going off the scales, and there not being any property for anyone to buy, those who have bought and those who are, you know, letting their properties out, landlords, you know, aren't thought about, you know, in a very favorable light, because number one, you know, they were part of the reason, you know, as to why the crash came about. And number two, these are the people that are, you know, perceived to be hoarding all of the housing, whereas, you know, other people are struggling. So, yeah, it's
a negative connotation.
Just a negative atmosphere.
On that basis then, like, and you think about your peer group, your mates, friends, or colleagues back in Ireland, like, how do you make money then if you're not doing it through property investment? Like, how are they creating wealth? Well, they're not. They're just blowing on beer every night.
Yeah, they're blowing on. Yeah. Well, yeah. Like, it's,
you know, your disposable income's a lot lower. Yeah. There's a lot less of blowing beer.
Yeah. Yeah. No, I think it's, you know, I suppose it's the same in every country, but, you know, to work is a privilege, not a right. And, you know, people are happy to work from day to day and, you know, put the bit of money that they have away into their savings account or shares or whatever it might be, buy their own home and just live their life that way. Most people probably don't have the luxury of the opportunities and options that are, you know, available to people here in Australia.
Mm. When we come back, I'm going to ask the guys about how they go about managing their property. We'll be back soon. Welcome back, everyone. I'm here with Will and Michael Magee. We're chatting property. A couple of guys from Ireland who have made Australia their home and are using Australian property as a vehicle to create wealth. Now, guys, I want to chat about how you manage your property. There's only one in there, but sort of moving forward for a portfolio. But before I do, we spoke really quickly about your attitudes towards debt and your contribution to this sort of combined strategy. What's been the thing, and I'll ask you individually, what's been the one thing that's pissed you most off about the other partner in this journey so far that you think you don't want to go through that process again? Will?
Oh, well, it's a tough one because it's probably not anything to do with the property journey that pisses me off. It's the fact that he's known as the time burglar because he wastes so much of my time. You have no idea how much time I spent standing at the front door waiting for him whenever we're going anywhere. But if I'm able to put up with his time wasting, and he does waste a lot of time, everything else along the property investment journey is easy enough.
Pretty fair, reasonably.
Yeah, I've no reservations at having my younger brother as as my partner when it comes to investments. Absolutely, if anybody in this world, I'd trust him, you know, implicitly about, you know, these big financial decisions. You know, my dad not so much so, but you know, my younger brother. No, there's absolutely no challenges there.
So if this were to go wrong, where do you think it could go wrong? Like, you know,
it's hard to see now, but yeah, look, it, you know, perhaps down the line.
I don't want to be negative about it, you know.
Well, because we're taking the accountant's advice and we're going one for one in buying property. If we don't set things up correctly, if either of us end up walking down the aisle, you know, we could cause headaches for ourselves there.
Mm. Or if we bought somewhere we were both actually living in, because now, you know, we rent where we want to live, obviously, and, you know, invest where we want to buy. And so say we bought a house, say, you know, down by the beach, and then one of us said, actually, I want to live here with my wife. You know, you're going to have to
talk about that. Shotgun first, call on that house.
You sort of, but I think the point I'm making is that, because a lot of people like the idea of doing what you're doing, and you're fortunate that you're very close and you've got a lot of shared experience, right? And that sort of helps. But I think the frankness of how you're able to sort of chat about these things is really fundamental if anyone wants to go down this path doing this sort of stuff, because, you know, the idea is good and it can really amplify your ability to create wealth through property if you're doubling down on your ability to create the funds to buy. But a lot of times it goes wrong. So, you know, my observation, my recommendation for anyone looking to do this is that you've got to know the person inside out, you know.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
And, yeah, you guys are quite close, but, you know, other people that might just be mates, you know, I would recommend putting an agreement in place on that basis. But everyone's got to make their own choice. You know, I think your strategy in terms of one for one is really smart, whatever your, you know, the fact that your accountant has suggested doing it that way, because you're future-proofing it.
Yeah.
Really,
yeah.
You know. The only challenge you got, though, is that if someone's deemed to be – get the better asset than the other one, right?
Like, yeah.
You know, this is...
Well, idea is, you know, I mean, neither of us are looking to shift either of them or, you know, living them or whatever it is. So it's, you know, we both own 50% of whatever it is that we have, you know.
Yeah, that's exactly it. It doesn't matter which one's performing better.
Yeah, and again, it comes back to the old trust thing. And, yeah.
Yeah. So, and sometimes you just got to go with it, right? Yeah. Like, you know, it'll sort itself out. And, that's how I see it.
But if we were both just saving, Phil, we'd still be saving for our first property each, you know. So now we're a year ahead, you know, foot in the ladder, not something to think about.
And that's timing the market, right?
Exactly.
You know, timing the market is hard. Like, you never pick the bottom. You might get close, but your time in the market as a property investor is what shapes your ability to create wealth.
Yeah, if you get in earlier, a buyer's agent, right?
Yeah. If you get in earlier and you buy a good asset with a view to create capital growth, and that's where a lot of people go wrong. They go, I'm gonna, and they never do it, right? So even if you know, set the world on fire and you might enter a market a year before and it might not do much, but you're in the market for when that thing does fire or start moving forward. So that's pretty cool. So who, in terms of managing the property, and you call it a portfolio of one, but managing the property, who pays the bills, who sort of reconciles statements from the property manager, who does all that sort of stuff out of you guys?
Well, it goes into an offset account, so we just put everything in there. So that's kind of, we put chip into that.
Yeah,
so.
And then we just get charged by the property manager.
The property, yeah. Okay, so it goes into offset. So do you guys save your money in that offset?
Yeah. Against,
yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
So what percentage of your debt, I don't need to know numbers, but what percentage of your debt on this first property right now do you think is offset by your savings?
A tiny amount.
Tiny amount.
Yeah. Oh, I don't know. What percentage of the debt, maybe not even...
No, I don't know. We've lost it up to $200,000, so I think.
Yeah, I don't know. I'd say maybe
a bit.
Yeah. 20% maybe.
So who recommended that you save in an offset connected to?
The broker.
Okay. That's another good strategy.
Yeah.
Were you familiar with that before?
No, I didn't have a clue, no.
Yeah. So what the guys are chatting about, so rather than just having your savings in a saving account getting maybe at best 1% interest, you chuck it into an offset account, which reduces the amount of interest you pay on the debt that you have. So if you have $200,000 mortgage and you have $100,000 in your offset account, essentially you're paying your debt monthly mortgage at $100,000.
Yeah.
So it's a really good strategy. That's cool. So you happy? You happy being property investors?
Yeah, sure. Yeah. When you get the first one, then you're just dying to get the next one under your belt.
How'd you celebrate the first one?
Oh, what did we do? I can't even remember.
Well, obviously, it was a good celebration, if you can remember. A
couple of beers. A couple of
bottles of cheap pop somewhere, no doubt. Yeah. You know? But all right. Well, let's have a chat next time.
Get it. Thanks for having us on, Phil.
Yeah, no worries. Great. So when you're ready to start this next cycle, so you got your cash, you're ready to roll.
Yeah.
Let's get you in beforehand, have a chat about it, and let's see what you end up with. So we'll do a couple of podcasts on
yeah,
that.
Yeah, cool. Yeah, definitely.
That'd be good.
Brilliant.
Yeah, nice one.
Great chat.
Thanks for having me on, Phil.
Well done, guys. Thank you.
Bye.
Remember to check out smartpropertyinvestment.com.au. If you're not yet subscribing to our daily morning newsletter, so you're the first to know what's happening in property and property investment right across Australia, and hear great stories like we have had today from Michael and Will Magee, smartpropertyinvestment.com.au/subscribe. Social media, just search Smart Property HQ. And I must get a lot of emails all the time, editor@smartpropertyinvestment.com.au, saying how you can help Smart Property Investment. There's two ways you can do it, and I would appreciate if you can do this. Number one, guests. We're looking for guests right across Australia from all walks of life, whether they've got one property or 50 properties. Come in and have a chat with us, share the story. The community really do appreciate it. And number two, there's a big engine behind the podcast here. It's just not me chatting behind a microphone, and they get a real kick out of those 5-star reviews coming out of iTunes or wherever you listen to it. So please do that, and you can contribute to how we can continue to grow the podcast. We'll be back again next time. Until then, bye-bye.
The information featured in this podcast is general in nature and does not take into consideration your financial situation or individual needs, and should not be relied upon. Before making any investment, insurance, tax, property, or financial planning decision, you should consult a licensed professional who can advise whether your decision is appropriate for you. Guests appearing on this podcast may have a commercial relationship with the companies mentioned.